Heads up.
Good afternoon, and thank you all for joining us today for the rollout of the America's Wildlife Habitat Conservation Act. This is a logical and forward-thinking solution to restore and maintain habitat for America's wildlife. America is blessed with abundant lands, fish, and wildlife, but we need a long-term vision that doesn't take this abundance for granted. Unfortunately, a misguided approach led by short-term thinking and a lack of action by the federal government has harmed America's fish and wildlife by passively sitting by and allowing their habitat to be burned, destroyed, and mismanaged. If that sounds depressing and unsustainable, it is. But there's good news that we know doesn't have, we don't have to keep it this way. By strengthening relationships between states, tribes, private landowners, and the federal government, we can allow them to implement proactive habitat conservation that will make a difference where it counts, and that's on the ground across our abundant outdoors. This new legislation is precisely the right tool for the job. America's Wildlife Habitat Conservation Act is visionary, logical, and reasonable policy that will proactively use tools and knowledge to improve habitat. Through grant funding, this legislation will invest $320 million annually into state and tribal wildlife habitat conservation. No one knows how to manage species better than the communities that live closest to them. So this bill will empower states by giving them the opportunity to develop recovery strategies for species that are listed as threatened or are candidates to be listed. The legislation will build incentives within the ESA that incentivize recovery by tying together recovery goals and regulatory relief for listed species. As a forester and a lifelong outdoorsman, I'm also excited about the ways this bill will promote forest management projects and support collaboration with private partners to conserve habitat. Ultimately, this bill diagnoses the problem with wildlife management, which is short-term band-aids over systemic issues. Instead of being content with the status quo, the America's Wildlife Habitat Conservation Act will implement proven solutions for restoring habitat in order to recover species. America's rich biodiversity deserves nothing less. Before I close, I would like to specifically thank Ducks Unlimited, the Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies, the Nature Conservancy, Safari Club International, and the many other organizations and stakeholders who have shown their support for this legislation. Their leadership on these issues has been instrumental in educating the American public and advancing sound science. These are organizations that actually know how to do conservation and know how to do it right and how to take care of habitat, and they've given us great examples all across the country that need to be replicated. It's time to implement the common sense, financially responsible programs that are in this bill, and it's time to get to work with our colleagues, not just in Congress, but across our federal government and across our country to make this happen. I'm so excited today to have several of my colleagues with me that will make brief remarks, and I want to start with someone who's worked tirelessly on all issues pertaining to rural America, and especially as the things that the Western Caucus works on, and that's the chairman of the Congressional Western Caucus from Washington State, Dan Newhouse.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you, Chairman Westerman. Appreciate that very much. And thanks for the opportunity to help introduce some very, very important legislation. As Bruce said, I'm Dan Newhouse. I'm chairman of the Congressional Western Caucus, which, let me brag just for a second, is a group of over 100 bipartisan members of Congress that focus on issues that are important to rural America. We've got members from across the country, and certainly the Western type issues are our focus. Proper management of our species and conservation of our public and private lands are truly two of the very most important of those key issues. While noble in its intent, you know that the Endangered Species Act, in so many ways, has failed in its mission to recover and delist species. And instead, unfortunately, in some instances, has been used as a tool to control the rights of private landowners. We have to improve species conservation efforts by empowering state and local-led efforts and avoid a one-size-fits-all approach to species recovery. You know, what works to recover a species in my state of Washington may not work in the great state of Arkansas or Georgia or Montana. The America's Wildlife Habitat Conservation Act, always easy to say, delivers critical support to the individuals on the ground who have been tasked with preserving and restoring at-risk habitats to better manage those species. Because we know that the best stewards of the land are the ones whose communities rely on a healthy landscape. By providing greater incentives to conserve on our public lands and our private lands, we can work hand in hand with local partners to conserve our wildlife in a way that works for everyone and for the species. I'm proud to co-sponsor this important legislation, and I would like to thank Chairman Westerman, who is also, I'm proud to say, a vice chairman of the Congressional Western Caucus, for his leadership on this very important issue. So, Bruce, I look forward to working with you on this, as well as other members that are here, and on additional future efforts that will make laws work better for species recovery, including reforms to the ESA through our ESA working group. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dan, and thank you again for your leadership on the Western Caucus. I now want to introduce a member of the Energy and Commerce Committee from Georgia, Buddy Carter.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank y'all for being here. I'm Buddy Carter. I have the honor and privilege of representing the 1st Congressional District of Georgia, which encompasses the entire coast of Georgia, over 100 miles of pristine coastline. Obviously, the environment is extremely important to us. We love the coast of Georgia. We love Georgia and South Georgia. It's just a great, great area. We have a number of different sites, the Okefenokee Swamp, the Savannah River Refuge, Wildlife Refuge, all of these within our district, and all of them are extremely important. You know, some of my fondest memories of growing up, first of all, this is my home. It's where I've lived all my life, where I intend to live the rest of my life. But some of my fondest memories growing up were going fishing with my dad, and I want my children, my grandchildren, to have those same experiences and have those same memories. So it is very important to us, and that's why this legislation is so vitally important. So how do we protect our environment? How do we protect in a smart way? And that's the key. I think the key word here is smart, because that's the way we want to do it. We can achieve this goal through strategic investments in conservation projects and smart policies that work not just on paper, not just in the courtroom, but work realistically and work in the environment that they intend to protect. That's very important. I want to tell you, right now, the NOAA is considering a law to help protect the right whales. Now, the mating season for the right whales is about a six-month period, and it's off the Atlantic coast. It starts at Georgia and goes up to, I believe, almost to New Jersey. But it is extremely important. Look, the right whales are endangered. We want to protect them. We love the right whales. All of us do. We want to make sure that they're protected. But the proposals that they are looking at now and decreasing or implementing speed limits, I should say, on boats from the size of 35 to 65 foot would essentially just crush our recreational fishing. And that's a billion-dollar industry in the state of Georgia alone. There's a smarter way to do this. This past summer, I was in Canada. I was in Montreal, and we were having a presentation by Meta Canada. And they were telling us that they had the technology now where they can actually trace species in the wild. And I asked them, I said, can you trace right whales? And they said, yes, we can do that. And I said, do you have to tag them? No, we can do it without tagging them. There's an example of how we can trace these species now and use technology, modern technology, as opposed to having to implement laws that are going to have a negative impact, I should say, on our environment. So our economy. If we do away with recreational fishing in the state of Georgia, just along the coast of Georgia, we'll be ruining essentially and crushing a $1 billion industry. And that's not smart. Not only that, but we have two major seaports in our district, the Port of Savannah and the Port of Brunswick. And if we have an impact on that, it will impact our economy as well. So there's a smarter way of doing things, and that's why this act is so important. It brings us into the 21st century. And I compliment and applaud Chairman Westerman for this, and that's why I'm glad to be a co-sponsor. Let's use smart policies. That's all we're saying. And thank you again, Chairman Westerman, for doing this and sponsoring this and giving me the opportunity to be a co-sponsor of it. Thank you, and I'll yield back.
Thank you, buddy. Our next speaker is by far the person that comes the longest to get to Congress from American Samoa, Amata Radowagon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Talofalava. I represent beautiful islands in the South Pacific, and much of our wildlife is unique in terms of U.S. native wildlife. Our land is covered with tropical rainforest, teeming with life, and rugged mountainous coastlines and coral reefs. We have abundant small wildlife, lovely birds on land, large coconut crabs, and in our waters, everything from whales to microscopic life, and we value all of them. One animal has become somewhat symbolic of American Samoa in art and culture, our flying fox. A large fruit bat was chosen for our National Park of American Samoa Quarter by the U.S. Mint. It's a vital part of our rainforest ecology, and we have seabird habitat, such as our steep, uninhabited Pola Island at Waiava Strait Natural Landmark. We have many land snails, sisivao, ranging from common to rare, some found only in the Samoan Islands that leave behind shells. Like these on this handmade Samoan ula. So thank you, Chairman Westerman, for this great bill. I'm delighted to support it. Our people in our national park would make any of you very welcome if you are ever in the South Pacific to see our wonderful wildlife. Thank you. Soifua ma'ia manwia.
Thank you, Amata, and thank you for reminding us that wildlife habitat management isn't a one-size-fits-all, and that's why it is important to empower local authorities, states, tribes, and territories to manage in the specific habitats. Next guy's from a state that knows a little bit about wildlife, Matt Rosendale from Montana.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Hello, everyone, and thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I appreciate the opportunity to be here with you. This is a critically important issue. Montana's been dealing with it for quite some time. The Biden administration's Green New Deal policies are restricting every state in the nation's sovereign right to self-govern. One of the tools that they've been using to enforce their restrictions is the Endangered Species Act. In my district alone, two animals, the grizzly bear and the wolverine, are seemingly listed just to cause a headache for Montanans and allow the federal government more control over private property. Since the grizzly bear was first listed, it has consistently exceeded the set recovery targets. Now, there are over 1,000 grizzlies in the Northern Continental Divide population, and also over 1,000 grizzlies that are existing in the Greater Yellowstone population. So in the state of Montana alone, we have over 2,000 grizzly bears, which is about 300% of what the target populations actually were. When listing the wolverine, the population estimates that determined the animal were threatened, the information that they used, was a decade old. was a decade old, and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service themselves admitted that the decision was based on lacking, and I quote this from their report, lacking or very sparse data. States cannot afford to restrict the production, the activities, and the recreation its residents based on flawed models and projections. That's why the America's Wildlife Habitat Conservation Act is so essential. States must be empowered to make the decision based on the needs of their residents and on true science, not federal government mandates. They should be able to create their own goals and their own stipulations for what is needed to preserve the environment they live in. Montana has already demonstrated the ability to do this after the delisting of the wolves. We've been managing the wolf populations for years now, a decade, and the population continues to grow because the Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks Department is managing it, not the federal government. This legislation will allow that type of work to continue. It will curb the federal overreach that has led to only 3% of the animals being delisted that had ever been listed under the Endangered Species Act. It will allow those most familiar with the animals, plants, and terrain of an area to decide when the populations need to be protected. And it will completely be offset within 5 years, making these changes good for the environment and good for America's bottom line on our budget. It is time for Washington bureaucrats to give the power back to the people and to simply follow the facts. This will strengthen our communities and put an end to the less unjustified regulations. Thank you very much. Mr. Chair, I yield back. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. And finally, our last speaker is also someone from a state that knows a lot about wildlife habitat and someone I hope to get on the Natural Resources Committee someday when a position opens up. From the great state of Utah, Celeste McCoy.
Malloy, I said McCoy.
It's all right. Happens all the time. I answer to McCoy, I answer to Chelsea. It's fine. I'm proud to be a co-sponsor of this bill for a lot of reasons, but Mr. Westerman mentioned that I represent Utah, and Utah is known for a couple of things. I think we're known around the nation for our entrepreneurial spirit. We're a big small business state, and we're known for our outdoor recreation opportunities between our ski industry, our national parks, and our open public lands with a lot of space for hunting, hiking, and other recreational activities. Utah draws in a lot of people based on our natural resources. Before I ever had anything to do with Congress, I had a lot of professional experience helping local governments deal with the Endangered Species Act, and I've seen how difficult it is to make changes and how difficult it is to change a plan based on new information, new science, new data. So I'm really excited about this bill that will help turn the federal government into an actual partner with state and local governments and allow us the flexibility to do a better job of actually recovering species instead of just implementing plans and following the plans and imposing burdens on small businesses, which are really important in my state, and on outdoor recreation and using our natural resources, which are vital in my state. We're trying something new where the state and the local governments can be partners with the federal government and try to do what's right for species. So I'm proud to be a co-sponsor of this. I'm excited to see that we're moving in this direction and we're doing things that are good for states, for resources, and for the people we represent. Thank you.
Thank you, Celeste. And I was just kidding when I said she was our last speaker because I noticed that another member of the Resources Committee, certainly from a state that has a lot of wildlife habitat that needs some management on it, Lauren Boebert from Colorado.
Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For far too long, the Endangered Species Act has been weaponized against ranchers, farmers, and other landowners to lock up our lands and prevent multiple use activities that Coloradans and Americans need and enjoy. I applaud Chairman Westerman for his leadership, and I am grateful to join him in this effort to make permanent and much-needed reforms to the Endangered Species Act. Importantly, this bill ensures state management of species once recovery goals are met, which is a major win for taxpayers while also providing increased benefits for the actual species that are being managed. Private landowners are also incentivized through this legislation to be part of the solution, as opposed to having their land and property rights targeted and seized. We all endeavor to be good stewards of our land, and locking up our land artificially and unnecessarily does not allow us to be stewards of the land and the resources that we have been so abundantly blessed with. Equally important, this legislation also authorizes active forest management provisions that will reduce the size and frequency of wildfires in the West while also providing an important fix to the disastrous Cottonwood decision. In Colorado's 3rd District, wildfires are certainly a problem. There are 6 billion standing dead trees in the western United States, all creating a massive tinderbox waiting to ignite. If anyone in this room or listening today is concerned about carbon emissions, well, then we need to look to our forests, because one catastrophic wildfire emits more carbon emissions in a few short days than every vehicle running in my state of Colorado 24/7 for an entire year. We must be able to manage our forests, and that also provides good, healthy watershed. When our forests are unhealthy, so are our watersheds. This bill is fully paid for and uses slush funds in the Inflation Expansion Act and so-called infrastructure bill to ensure this legislation is also a good deal for taxpayers. I urge the committee of and the House to move this bill quickly and in its current form. Special thanks again to the chairman for his bold leadership on this legislation. I look forward to voting on this and supporting this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lauren. I'll now take questions. If you have questions for another member, we can direct them to there. Yes, sir.
Mike Doyle with ED News. In the Senate, the Recovering America's Wildlife Act has been reintroduced. Mm-hmm. Is yours meant as a counterpoint, then you'll eventually mesh up to negotiate a difference, or are you on two different tracks?
Both. So if you look at the last Congress, Recovering America's Wildlife Act passed the House but couldn't get through the Senate, and we had some real concerns about it. A lot of the goals in RAWA are goals that we like, but it was a $1.3 billion per year bill that was permanent mandatory spending with no offset. So that can't fly in the House right now. So we looked at a way to actually benefit all wildlife, including endangered species, by focusing on habitat and by really giving states the power and authority to do the management on the ground that needs to take place. So it's kind of like RAWA because it deals with creating better habitat and having more species going forward. It also uses some of the formula funding that came out of RAWA, where we're looking at state geography as much as we are population. Those kind of things are similar to RAWA, but I think this bill is different from RAWA in a lot of ways because it's strictly focused on wildlife habitat management and on getting results like recovery of species.
If I could follow up, then looking down the road, do you envision this going into a negotiation with the Senate and hash out your differences?
It's hard to envision what's going to happen with the Senate, but I think this bill can stand on its own, but we'll see what happens. And there's a lot of crossover, like I said, with RAWA, but this bill, I believe, is better than RAWA and is fiscally responsible, as well as will provide great habitat for our wildlife going forward. Alex?
Could you go into a little bit more detail about the offsets and how this pays for itself?
Yeah, there's, as was mentioned, the IIJA and the IRA put some money out there that's not being used. About $700 million over the five-year period would come out of NOAA. $700 million would come out of the Bureau of Reclamation. And then there's some programs that are authorized under Fish and Wildlife that have never been funded, that we would repeal those programs. So all of that added up gets you to the amount that we need to offset the $320 million per year.
Yes, sir.
All right. Jesse?
And then too, would there just be like certain prioritization toward certain areas or certain species that kind of are more at risk?
So, now every state has something called the State Wildlife Action Plan, and what the federal money does, it goes to these state agencies to implement their state wildlife action plan. And this is something they work on in conjunction with the federal government. So it would really empower the states to do the work to get to the goals in the wildlife action plan that has been agreed upon in the state and with the federal government. And it's a way to streamline that work. It also gives states the authority to do work on federal lands, including the U.S. Fish and Wildlife. We've got provisions in place called the Good Neighbor Authority that allows states to do work on Forest Service. And that this has worked out very well across the country, so we thought we should give states the ability to do that on Fish and Wildlife Service lands as well. What we got?
Have you talked to Representative Dingell, who's the lead Democratic sponsor of RAWA, about your bill? And do you see any sort of negotiation space in terms of the funding? Because that seems to be the biggest sticking point between the two bills right now.
Yeah, I would say the funding probably is the biggest sticking point, but there's also policy differences in it that, like I said, I think our bill actually does more to get the work done on the ground, and it's got more accountability and transparency to it. I have spoken with Representative Dingell. She's obviously passionate about her bill, and I think it's good to have an alternative out there. And I believe as we get into the details more, that more of my friends across the aisle will come along to support this bill. There's a lot of outside groups that have looked at it that are excited about it because they realize it will actually make a difference on the ground. It's not just sending money out of the door from DC. It's got provisions in it that will allow actual work to take place and good things to happen for wildlife habitat. And whether you're talking about endangered species or species that outdoorsmen hunt, they all benefit when you have good habitat. And we're not just talking about animal species, we're also talking about plant species. We can increase biodiversity for both plants and animals by doing good management on the ground. And that's something that's been proven over and over. And those organizations I mentioned earlier, they've got great projects. If you want to see demonstration projects, you can go all over the country and see what good wildlife habitat management looks at. And that's why I'm excited, because we're going to empower more of that to take place all across the country.
What's your time frame for hearing and markup?
We were scheduled for a hearing next week, and we're going to mark it up pretty soon after that.
Each of your colleagues talked not about the conservation funding, but about the ESA provisions, which seem to be pretty significant. Would you agree that the ESA elements will cause your greatest difficulty with the Democrats?
I don't think so, because if you look at these ESA provisions, they're common sense, and we've actually, Chairman Newhouse and I have put together an ESA working group, and we've had experts come in and talk about what are the problems with ESA? Why are we only seeing a 3% success rate for species that get on the endangered species list? And you know, some of this comes back to not having good recovery plans, not being able to measure whether species are actually being recovered or not. And I think there's bipartisan support for creating a metric where you can actually measure the success of recovery. And Dan, I don't know if you would like to add any more to that or not.
Yes. I think, addressing the shortcomings of ESA, which I think I said in my remarks was well-intentioned, but nobody can take pride in the fact that we have such a low success rate of recovering actual recovery of species. And so this is an effort to, like the chairman said, unleash or empower those local entities to actually do the work and get the work done. So, as he said, that's bipartisan in nature. Everybody wants success here. And so I think that we have a great chance of getting a bipartisan effort moving forward on this legislation. And if it includes some of the provisions of Ms. Dingell's legislation to make that happen, the chairman works very well across the aisle, as long as we're doing the right thing for the environment and for the species.
Thank you, Dan. Any other questions?
I had one more for Representative Carter. You mentioned the right whale I'm just curious what, if any, conversations you've had with NOAA about when they might release that final rule. I know it's been delayed for a while.
It has been delayed, and you know, of course, they've gotten a lot of public input, as you can imagine. And again, let me stress that, you know, we want to protect the right whale, too. What boater wants to strike a right whale? I mean, it's going to damage your boat. And what we're simply saying is that there's technology available now that can avoid this. Sonars and buoys and that type of thing. All of this is not being taken into account. You know, I used to be in the, I'm a healthcare professional, and I was in the nursing home business. We always used the analogy, you know, does the benefit outweigh the risk? And in this case, the benefit is obvious. We want to protect the right whales, but the risk of crushing our economy and destroying commercial fishing off of, recreational fishing and commercial fishing off of the state of Georgia and impacting our ports, which are the economic engine of our, of the southeastern United States, That's a high price to pay. So it's, you know, again, it's difficult, and all we're saying is let's look at all the technology that's available there. And I have to say that the approach that is being taken here with this legislation, that it should be at a state level, I think is extremely important.
Thank you, buddy. And there seems to be an idea in our country that conservation and economic success are mutually exclusive, but I would say the two go hand in hand. And if we would actually utilize the resources that God has blessed us with and manage those properly, it would be a boon not only to wildlife, but it would help tremendously with rural economies. I know in my district, we have so much potential, and we do a pretty good job even on federal lands of managing, but there's so much more potential to doing even more. And there's a project there which has been replicated many times that the Forest Service did. They did it for the red-cockaded woodpecker, and they went in and they thinned the timber and they burned, and they were able to use the sale of the timber to pay for the management cost. And they ended up not costing the taxpayer a dime and creating great habitat, not only for the red-cockaded woodpecker, which they're trapping and relocating to other places now, but you got more songbirds, more quail, more turkey, more deer. And they unleashed a seed bank where you had tremendous more plant biodiversity just because they did the right thing. And there's no reason we can't be replicating that for what works in my district and what works all across the country. And we have a tremendous amount of unleashed potential that I think this bill will help release. So if there are no more questions, we're going to wrap it up, and thank you all again for coming.